Welcome to Discussing Fitchburg Now. Thanks for joining us. Our show here is going to be on Fitchburg High School. Fitchburg High School are public high school options. So we're going to start with Monty Tech. Up next after Monty Tech, we're going to have Sizer School on. And closing out the show, we're going to have Fitchburg High School. So welcome, everyone, from Monty Tech.
Hello. It's great to be here.
Happy to be here.
So we have Superintendent Sheila, Principal Tom, and then we have a couple students from the Home Healthcare Occupation?
Health Occupation.
Yep. Grace and
Gladdy.
Mm-hmm. Welcome.
Thank you.
Okay. So, Monty Tech. What would you say the main advantages are for choosing Monty Tech?
So Monty Tech is a vocational school, and we actually represent not just Fitchburg, but actually two cities, Fitchburg-Gardner, and 16 towns all the way to the New Hampshire border. Mm. And we're their vocational school for students that are interested in learning a particular trade. And when they graduate from Monty Tech, they have the ability to go directly into the world of work, or if they choose to go on to college or work and go to college, they have that ability because they've just explored a potential college career for the next 3.5 years at Monty Tech and have a better idea when they graduate what they'd like to study when they go on to college.
So for the first half year, they are not they're picking their vocation?
Right, correct. So we actually have 20 different vocational technical programs.
20?
Yes. And we certainly don't expect 14-year-old students to be able to know exactly what they'd like to study at Monty Tech. So we actually have an exploratory program where the students actually see all 20.
All 20.
And then they select their top favorites that they would like to spend additional time in, and that's the exploratory program. Mm. So in our schedule, they have 1 week of academics and the opposite week vocational. And so always half of the school is in the vocational program. The other half are getting their high school requirements for graduation.
That's right, grade 9 through 12?
It is.
Week on, 1 week off?
You got it. Mm. And then after the first semester freshman year, in fact, we'll be giving out the placements for our freshmen tomorrow. They actually, after they finish the exploratory, they select what they would like to study at Monty Tech for the next 3.5 years.
Mm-hmm.
So it's an exciting time.
So the benefit, a major benefit to Monty Tech is a vocational career.
Correct.
And also college readiness.
Right. Yes. So many of our students, they actually, when they graduate from Monty Tech, have industry recognized credentials and certifications. And our students will certainly share with you all the different credentials they've earned. But they're also going to earn, in many cases, college credits through articulation and dual enrollment as well.
Mm-hmm.
It really gives them a heads up of, you know, what they'd like to do in their future, and it gives them that time to establish as they mature and become young adults the path that they'd like to continue to walk.
That sounds pretty good. So do you get 2 degrees?
Yes, we get our trade, and then we get our high school diploma as well.
So you got 2 degrees right off the bat.
Mm-hmm. Within our trades as well, we have different certifications. So we get OSHA as health students. We become a certified nursing assistant, certified medical assistant, and EMT. We're AED certified as well, CPR certified. So we have everything within it.
You can choose all of those things to become certified in,
That's part of the program that we chose. So we chose the health occupations program. So that's all included.
So you become an EMT and a certified nurse. You become all those things.
Yes.
As long as you pass the test.
Yes, of course. Yeah. And our teachers prepare us well for that.
Mm-hmm. That sounds excellent.
Yeah.
So you can immediately graduate and go to a number of careers.
And a lot of our students are actually starting their career before they even leave because we do have something called cooperative education.
Oh, co-op.
Co-op. So starting your junior year, your second half of your junior year, you're eligible to go out on co-op, which allows, instead of going to during their shop week, instead of being in shop, they'll actually go out and work for one of our community partners. It could be whether it's a nursing home for these guys, one of the hospitals, but we have a vast number of students. So this year, as a matter of fact, we already have about 110 students that are already out on co-op, which means they're earning money during that week. They're paid a salary. So they're getting their education 1 week, and then they're earning a salary the second week.
Are all of the co-op jobs paid?
Yes. Mm-hmm.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. All?
All. Mm-hmm.
Are employers required to pay students, or are there
We have other types of things that set up students, whether it's an outplacement or something like that, an externship, where some of those aren't. For instance, the underclassmen for Health Oc will go out, and they'll spend the day, but they're not necessarily paid to do that position.
Mm-hmm. And we have 350 business and higher ed partners that really help us keep our finger on the pulse of what's
350 connected businesses.
Directly
so
connected.
So you can give them a call and say, hey, I have... five students.
Right, but we actually meet with them 3 times a year.
Oh, yeah?
So they actually look at our curriculum. They examine our textbooks as well as all our machinery and equipment that we have. And they put together with our faculty a 5-year equipment list of what is expected. If there's new industry-recognized credentials...
Up-to-date things.
Right. They'll say, please embed this in, because they want to make sure when our students are graduating that they're graduating to be career-ready. So anything that we can do to help prepare that, we do. And that way we're not educating blindly. They're leading us in that direction.
So... we did a poll in Discussing Fitchburg Now, a Facebook group, of for those of you with kids in middle school or earlier and plan on sending them to public high school, where are you looking into sending your kids? And Monty Tech got the majority vote at 51, FHS got 25, and Sizer got 7 votes. So my question is, with your school being so desirable, right, and you serve 18 communities?
Yes.
How many students apply versus how many students do you have to turn down?
So we actually have 1,435 students at our school, and we are maxed out.
At 1,435?
Yes.
So did you have to turn any students down?
Unfortunately, we did. A little less, about 125 students, and I feel, and we all feel very badly about that. Certainly, we'd like to be able to take every student in that wants to be educated at Monty Tech. Mm-hmm. But I'm thrilled that you're actually doing a program like this to showcase all the schools, because both Sizer and Fitchburg are excellent schools with incredible opportunities.
Yeah.
And it's been
all
wonderful.
Different.
Correct.
Different,
and it's options. Great for parents to have options, and I'm really happy that you're actually showcasing this, because there are great opportunities for Fitchburg residents.
Absolutely. Mm-hmm. So what percentage of, obviously, 125 kids out of 1,435 is pretty low. Are a lot of those kids, do they apply for different exploratory programs, but they don't get them? So they have to pick a first, second, third?
No, these are the students that are on the waiting list didn't make it into the school.
Right.
As freshmen. So they can reapply as sophomores or juniors.
Really?
In some cases. So if there's a particular shop that's open that they're interested in and we have an available seat, we will take an upperclassman.
What are the criteria for choosing a student? Is it simply by lottery, or is it by grade average choice?
No, every student applies. They have there's an application. This year we started with an online application. And factors include academics, conduct, attendance. They get a rating from their current middle school guidance counselor. And then all students come in. These guys went through the process. You come in and you interview with Ms. Curry, who's our director of admissions. And all those things are then factored in. And there's a score that comes from that. That's how it's determined.
So it's you get assigned a number value.
Correct.
And then you, mm-hmm. yep. The lowest numbers.
Right. And well, what it is that we actually start out with taking students by quota, by the town. Each of our 18 towns has a designated number of how many students they're allotted or how many slots they're allotted.
So it's not simply by top number. You start with the quota.
Correct. So you do it by town first, and that lasts till June 1st. We start taking students in April, notifying them that they've been accepted. And then after June 1st, it goes from the individual towns to just one general list. And then we just draw and follow that list from there.
Mm-hmm. So what is the most popular vocational program? And maybe you can name a few of them.
Maybe we'll have our students start. What do you think is the most popular?
Health occupations.
Is it?
Health, yes. Yeah, and Cosmo. Cosmetology is very mm-hmm. popular as well.
What
yeah.
about culinary arts?
Culinary arts. Yes. It's up there, yeah.
Graphic communications also is very popular.
Yeah, mm-hmm. for our artsy students.
Mm-hmm.
They fit well there.
Yeah. And what are some other things you have? Carpentry?
Well, actually, to meet one of our student needs. Our students have told us that they really want to work with animals.
Mm.
So what we did is we went to school committee and we said, if we potentially raise the money, and could we possibly start a veterinary science program? And they said, sure, absolutely. So right now we've raised $2.5 million in private sector funds, foundations, grants, and in-kind donations. And our own construction students right now are building a 7,500-square-foot veterinary clinic right on our campus.
So you can get the masonry, the carpentry, the plumbing, the electrical.
HVAC.
HVAC.
You got it.
Oh.
So we're actually, in fact, they're showing a slide of it right now. This is
the new veterinary center?
Yeah. Correct. So the plan
I saw it under construction a couple weeks ago.
Right. And
looks
it's coming
good.
Along nicely. We'll have it all buttoned up within the next couple weeks, and we're thrilled about that. But our own 16 and 17-year-old students in our construction trades are building this for their school. And the plan is we'll be opening a vet tech, vet science program starting with the ninth graders next year, so they'll go through the exploratory.
So it's going to start 2018?
Yeah,
2017, September?
Correct. Yeah. And then when it's completed,
that'll be popular.
In a few years, once we have our students that are juniors, we're going to open the program up and partner with Becker College. Becker has given us their veterinary doctor, and we're going to open the clinic for actually families in all of our 18 communities that can't afford proper animal care. So we're going to be able to service their pets at a significantly reduced cost.
That's fantastic.
And also, Becker was so appreciative of the program, they became our higher ed partner, and they also are looking at our curriculum and are going to be offering our graduates from the program 6 college credits.
Would be a dual enrollment program?
Correct. They can earn college credits and not have to pay for them. And now Montachusett Community College would like to partner with us as well. And they're in the process of starting their own associate's degree in veterinary science. So it would be a beautiful pipeline. Students can go directly into the world to work as a vet assistant. They can work in the clinic alongside a veterinary doctor. They can go on to get an associate's degree and then continue over to Becker or go directly to Becker. There'll be a lot of options for the students. And
it really
stemmed from our students wanting to work with animals. So some of our students that were interested in the medical field wanted to work with human beings. Others said, you know, we really would like a program with animals.
God, we looked at, I'm a senior.
I know.
And we looked at the workforce needs. So we're really driven by, you know, if our students are graduating, is there going to be a job there waiting?
And then you're talking to the different businesses and seeing what do you need for...
Right, and we actually put an advisory together for the veterinary science. The veterinary doctors in all of North Central Mass have joined us. We have 20 veterinary doctors that are helping us put the curriculum together. They helped us actually pick out all the equipment, supplies, and materials that will be in the clinic. They helped with the entire layout of the floor and the flow of the clinic, and their advice has been invaluable.
So you'll be able to get right into being a veterinary assistant and theoretically be able to move into a college to become a veterinarian.
Correct. So you can actually start as a vet assistant, get a vet tech certification, and then go on to be a veterinary doctor. A win-win for everybody.
It is.
A win for our school because our students are going to be studying what they want to learn. Workforce needs are very high in this area, so we'll certainly have that workforce placement, and a win for our community because animals that aren't getting service now will have that opportunity.
And the low cost option, that'll be fantastic.
Absolutely.
And cosmetology does,
yes.
Right?
Mm. Yeah.
Okay. Great. All right, let's see what else I have, some questions. So AP classes dual enrollment. How does that work? Do you have AP? You have AP classes.
We do. Yeah, we've been adding AP classes. We're going. I'm not sure you guys.
Yeah, I took AP and dual enrollment.
Do you pay for dual enrollment? Do you pay for college dual enrollment? How does that work?
It depends on the course. We have courses that are after school that students pay the whopping fee of $30 to get credits with Montachusett. Or we have dual enrollment articulations with classes like our biotech class and our math modeling classes.
Articulations?
Yep. So that's basically an agreement with the school that we make sure that our curriculum aligns with their curriculum.
With different schools or just with Montachusett?
No, we have multiple schools all over the place that we have articulations with that will allow credits and everything else.
Mm-hmm. So Fitchburg State University?
Absolutely. Yep. Johnson and Wales, Worcester
State. For Culinary Arts.
Fitchburg, Framingham.
So you can, if you're advanced enough, you can take a college credit class that's good for the college that you want to go to.
Correct.
For instance, the two aside of you, they're earning eight college credits free of charge in the EMT course.
Yeah.
Because we've partnered with Montachusett.
And what's the value on that?
Approximately $245 per course, but it's 8 credits, so you're going to do more than double it.
Right. According to the Mount, last year, the group of Monty Tech students that went to the Mount because of articulation saved $44,000.
$44,000, right off the bat.
Yeah. Correct.
And you have 2 degrees.
It's pretty expensive.
That's awesome.
It is. We're trying to make education valuable for our students, but at the same time, we also know families are struggling. If they choose to go on to college, we want to make it more affordable. So we always look internally of how we could partner. It won't cost us anything, and our faculty has been very receptive to looking at our curriculum and working with various
adjusting
colleges.
It so that it works for the college.
Mm-hmm. And they'll agree to the 3 credits. Mm-hmm. As long as, in most cases, the agreements are if you have to keep a B or better, and it's a great incentive for our students to keep
work
up
hard
with their grades. Yeah. You got it.
What do you have in terms of athletic programs?
You play, so we'll let you say.
Yes, we have about 16 athletic sports to choose from. Personally, I am on the varsity field hockey team as a varsity captain. Each season, we have various amounts. We have about 5 to 6 sports per season, boys and girls. I know in the fall, we have field hockey, we have football, we have volleyball.
Cheerleading.
Yes, and then in the winter, we have cheerleading again. We have a basketball. And we have hockey. And then in the spring, we have lacrosse, we have baseball, softball. We offer many options.
Sounds like you've got all of them. Sounds like you cover all the athletic
swimming,
bases.
Golf.
Golf.
Yeah. It's
skiing?
All free.
Skiing we do not have.
I thought
you'd
do the
ski trips.
Yeah.
I don't think we have any kids.
And what about art, music, theater courses? Are any of those?
So that's a big push that we're actually looking at right now. We had an opportunity to pair with Leominster High School, actually, to do a small band program this year. We put on our first couple concerts, so that went very well. We're very lucky, fortunate that we have a teacher who's dual certified in both phys ed and art. So she started with an art elective this year called Yoga and Meditative Art. And the students came running to us. One of their classmates was yelling at me the other day, said, we need more art. Shashaley was yelling. So we're looking to add some more art classes next year as well.
Mm-hmm. Well, that's one thing with the vocational, 1 week on, 1 week off. There's not a lot of room in the schedule for for other activities.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Okay, let's see. I got one first for you guys. What did you think the school was going to be like before you attended, and was there anything that surprised you when you became a student?
Personally, when I went to go to apply for Monty Tech, I had several options. I had the Honors Academy at Fitchburg, I had Oakmont, and what really stood out to me at Monty Tech was the opportunities not only within the trades, but when you look at the academic opportunities of honors classes, AP courses, dual enrollment, and then you also look at the extracurricular activities. So when I originally imagined going, I figured, oh, it would be so nice, I'm going to learn so much, and it's going to be a lot of work. And in the end, it was, but all the teachers worked so well with you, so when I got there, I was so nervous, because you have that 1 week on, 1 week off of academics. So you're learning the same amount of academics a typical high school student would in half the time, as well as a whole trade. So coming to Monty Tech, it's really opened my eyes to the real world experience. And you're doing a lot of work, but the benefits are unbelievable.
So it's more work than you anticipated.
Yes, but,
but it's manageable.
In a good way. In a good way. You walk away with so much. And the teachers are fantastic. I have math teachers that I don't even go to, and they'll sit down with me, make sure I'm understanding everything I'm learning. And they really take the time to work with you. If they have a free period, they'll sit down with you, no matter what subject, no matter what time.
Great.
Yeah, that's what I really appreciate appreciate about our teachers at Monty Tech. They understand that we're high school students and sometimes life gets stressful and we've got to go to work and we want to participate in every single club and sometimes we get our hands too full, but they're always there to make sure we're getting our grades up and we're doing good. They're there before school, they're there after school, they're there over email.
Very responsive.
Of them will answer you at 2 in the morning when you're freaking out about your homework. So I'm really appreciative about
the teachers there. So great experience.
Oh, yes. Yes. All right.
Fantastic. Well, thanks everyone for coming on and telling us about Monty Tech.
Thank you.
All right, so we're going to cut to a quick break and then we're bringing on Sizer School. Hi, Sam Squally here with Sally Cragen, and we are talking about the low-cost cat and dog vaccine clinic that's coming up at the fire station.
Yes, Saturday, March 4th from 10 a.m. to noon, area pet owners, and this is open to everybody, can bring your dogs and cats for a very low-cost rabies vaccine, microchip, and parvo distemper.
So that's only $10 for the rabies, $10 for the distemper, and $20 for the microchip.
Exactly. And this is the kind of vaccine that would cost quite a bit more in a veterinarian's office. We would like to encourage you to bring your animal into a vet for a well pet visit. But if you come to our clinic for a low cost vaccine, you will be saving money.
Yeah, it's a good price.
It's an excellent price, and it's first come, first served. We work with Second Chance Animal Shelter, and you can find them out in North Brookfield. My organization is Be Positive, Therapy Pets, and Community Education.
Yeah, and the Friends of Fitchburg Dogs is also helping sponsor. And we'll have tables set up for information on the Friends of Fitchburg Dogs, Fitchburg Dog Park, and Be Positive, and the Therapaws Therapy Pets.
Absolutely, and it's a wonderful event. We will be getting flyers to all Fitchburg Public School children to bring home. We'll also be doing a lot more talking about this as time comes. So save some money, come to our low-cost rabies vaccine clinic at Fitchburg Fire Station.
And this is cash only, right?
They will take checks. They will not take credit cards.
Mm-hmm. So check or cash. Cats must be in carriers and dogs must be on leashes. And as long as you get there before noon, they will see you.
They will. And people do line up for this early, and it's really fun. People get to meet their neighbors, and we get to see
dog costumes.
Dog costumes. We've got stickers. We've got giveaways. Oh, my goodness. We've got lots of fun happening there.
Yeah, so that's Saturday, March 4th at the Fitchburg Fire Station.
That's right behind Dunkin' Donuts at 33 North Street.
Okay. Thanks, Sally.
Thank you.
Welcome to Inside Fitchburg. I'm your host, Alex Cardinale.
Inside Fitchburg is pretty much a showcase of that work that folks are doing. A lot of conversation is really being steered in a really positive direction, and more is being found out, I feel, you know, now, which is really exciting stuff. Hey, we're back. I didn't have a microphone on. Live TV, everybody. I think you're one of the examples of what the city really needs, and that's, you know, young, energetic folks investing. You guys look great for $150. Do what you love and you don't work a day in your life. Inside the Actors Studio with James Lipton. If you haven't, James Lipton is an old guy with a beard. And what Pittsburgh is a lot of really good people working toward a better future for the city.
Welcome back to Discussing Fitchburg Now. On here, I have Sizer School,
A North Central Charter Essential School.
North Central Charter Essential School.
Yes.
And Sizer for short.
Yes.
Sizer yes. School.
So you are a charter public high school.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. Yes. Yeah. So welcome. We have four students, and we have Principal
David Perrigo.
And
you've
got a long name, too.
Yes. I'm the Recruitment and Communications Coordinator, and I'm Kathleen Cragen.
Welcome.
Cool. Thanks for having us.
Okay. So we just had Monty Tech on to tell us all about them. How about we start with what is the main advantages to Sizer as a public high school?
I think like a big part of Sizer is how individualized they are and how hard the faculty works to meet your needs, whether it's like academic or social, emotional. Like I know when I first started Sizer, I was really struggling with my classes. And I was held back a lot in math, which is something I'm really passionate about. And I was given the opportunity, like they're really flexible there, so I was given the opportunity to take, to double and even triple in math classes. So I was able to go from taking pre-algebra my freshman year to taking calculus and college statistics in my senior year.
When did you start Sizer? What year? What grade?
In the eighth grade.
Eighth grade?
I think all of us started in the eighth grade, actually.
Yeah.
I started in
eighth.
Which is funny.
And what grade are you all in?
Seniors.
Senior.
All seniors.
I'm a junior. Mm-hmm. I stayed back, so I'm the same age as them.
But you're all in the same group.
Yes.
So we're 7 through 12. You can come at the 7th
grade. Through 12. Mm-hmm. Do you get a lot of students that come in the 8th or the 9th? Do you get a lot of students that come in the 9th grade where a typical high school would come in?
We do, yeah. Mm-hmm. Yep. Students come in at different ages. Generally, 7th, 8th, and 9th is our largest grades where the students join Sizer.
Are students mixed in different age groups? Seventh graders taking classes with ninth graders?
Sometimes they do. Yeah, we're divided into three divisions. So we have a middle school division and a 9-10 division and an 11-12 division 3. So sometimes those students mix there.
Sometimes they overlap. Yeah. But three divisions, 7-8, 9-10, 11-12.
Yeah. But for classes like Spanish or even gym and art and even some math classes, there's a lot of diversity within the age in the classroom. Mm-hmm. So you see a lot of different ages, so that's really cool.
So one of the main advantages is a personalized attention. So definitely. Are you saying that there are smaller class sizes than in a standard public high school?
Yes.
The largest class we've ever had is about like 20 kids. It usually stays between like 12 and 15.
There's usually about a dozen.
Yeah.
To 15 students in a class. Mm-hmm.
It's really nice because you get to like know the teacher throughout the year. So like getting to like learning from them is easier because you know them personally.
So do you have one teacher that teaches multiple classes?
Sometimes.
It depends. Yeah. So I know our Spanish teacher is the Spanish department because we have Spanish 1, Spanish 2, Spanish 3, and I believe Spanish 4 is online, and you can take it with her. It depends. And I know that she's basically the head of the department now because so many kids can just be like put together based on their skill levels. So sometimes it's that, or there's like the history department where it's each grade has their own representative for history.
Our physics teacher, for example, teaches physics, chemistry, and engineering.
Yeah.
So you might have a physics class and then have a Spanish class and then have a chemistry class and it's taught by the same physics teacher?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
So how many different teachers do you see in a typical day?
Usually probably 4 to 5.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
I think when you get like the older in the grade you get, you see like about like 3 or 4, but I think like the 7th and 8th graders definitely see like 5 or 6 mm-hmm. every day. So,
mm-hmm.
But because of like
so individualized attention, because you really get to know your teachers.
Yes, like because of the flexibility, I was never even like able to have a history class because I didn't personally like history, so I was able to take electives like with dual enrollment. So I like a teacher that they've had for like 2 years with history. I've never had her, so. I was able to take like psychology or like sociology and stuff with like Montachusett or Fitchburg State. Mm-hmm.
You're taking a class from Fitchburg State
or
Montachusett?
Yep.
So you're leaving the school and going to a different school?
Yes.
Uh-huh. And you're getting high school credit and college credit at the same time?
Yes.
That sounds good.
That's an opportunity for juniors and seniors.
Yeah. For juniors and seniors, that's an option.
Yeah.
For off-campus or off-high school property college learning.
We just recently signed a memorandum of understanding with Fitchburg State University, and starting in their junior year, our students are offered to take courses at Fitchburg State at no cost to us and at no cost to them.
Really?
And so our juniors who started last year as juniors and then continued this year will be graduating Sizer School with 12 college credits under their belt at no cost to either of us.
Mm-hmm. That's fantastic.
Yeah. I say the only downside to it is that you have to have, I think, a minimum of a 3.0 GPA.
You have to qualify.
You have to maintain.
Yeah.
That sounds reasonable.
Yeah. I guess.
All right. So what do you have for athletic programs?
Oh, we have basketball, I did field hockey.
I played basketball, soccer.
Track and field.
Softball, lacrosse. Mm-hmm. I feel like I'm missing something.
Because there's soccer in the fall and there's soccer in the winter, and that's just like that's a different thing. But I know those two types of soccer, depending. And then softball. Did we say softball?
Yeah. Softball, soccer, cross country. Yeah, yeah. And unfortunately, due to like the size of our school, we don't have a football team. Yeah. We don't have a volleyball team. Mm. So that's something that
I was just going to say, how many students do you have at the Sizer School?
We are currently enrolled at 376.
376. So that's a lot different than 1,400.
Yeah.
35 at Monty Tech.
Yeah.
Do you ever encounter that you want to do an athletic program or an art program, but there's not enough students that apply?
Yeah.
And so do you ever team with other schools?
Yes.
Or how does that work?
I know that's been a problem in the past with field hockey especially, because the size was so small. And I wanted to join, but I could. Well, I was more committed.
Three girls that show up.
Yeah, pretty much. But I was more committed to our theater program, mm-hmm. so I didn't want to, split my attention.
There's also, like a girl in our friend group who is a couple years ago. She does wrestling, and she did wrestling before she came to our school. And then she came, and she was like, "Well, it's unfortunate that we don't have a wrestling team here." So she co-opted with, I believe, Fitchburg High School and Monty Tech, just because they had like a little bit amount of kids, so they put them all together to create one team. And she was really happy with that, and I remember her talking about it and how cool it was to go against.
So do you have an agreement with the other high schools that you can combine kids in?
Our lacrosse team was actually partnered with Monty Tech, so we sometimes would practice at their school, or like they would come practice at our school.
Mm-hmm. I remember due to size, back when I first came to Sizer, we had a baseball team. But just like in ninth grade or eighth grade, we didn't have enough students to actually have it anymore, so we had to get rid of it. But a good thing about our school is if people came and they wanted to have a baseball team, they could initiate one and get a bunch of people to join in, and then we would have a baseball team again.
You can. Yeah. So how do you have a? Do you have? How does your school committee work, and how does your student at a student council?
Yeah.
So who makes those decisions?
Students mostly initiate it.
Yeah, our student council just got up and running. Like elections just happened, so like I don't know if I'm the 11th grade representative. I might be, whatever. but in the past,
come in yet?
Yeah, still waiting on that. But in the past, students can go to student council, and student council members can bring that to student council meetings. From there, they can go to the board of trustees. The student council has to come up with a proposal. I think I have the process right. So we would present that to the Board of Trustees.
So there's not a school committee like Fitchburg High or Monty Tech has. It's a Board of Trustees.
Board of Trustees, yeah.
How does that work?
So the Board of Trustees is made up of community members and faculty members, and they are basically the governing board of the school. And but a lot of the way the school works sort of comes from within, from students in the school or from faculty members in the school. So if there's a great interest, as Mitchell said, it can really happen. When I came on board, the students were really interested in getting a student council up and running, which hadn't been in the school for a while. And it was the first order of business, and we got it up and running, and it was very active last year. And a lot of good ideas came forward. One of our themes at Sizer is that we believe that education should be about students and about their lives. It's not so much about the information that students learn, but it's what they do with it and how it affects their lives and what it means to them. And so, as you can see, we have amazing students, and being at the center of their experience, and a lot of that is about having influence over the school. So. Trying to be authentic and having decisions about things that really matter to them. So I'm really excited because the school is going to make an adjustment to its physical. We have a brand new building, which is really exciting.
It's gorgeous.
Right, it's a nice building. But we have a little problem because the doorways to the stairways are very narrow. So at our last student convocation, somebody brought up the idea of it would be really nice if we could widen these doors so the students aren't even needing to bump into each other. And over February,
there's a bottleneck after classes.
And there's lots of traffic jams.
But February vacation is going to see a big change in that. And that's something that came about because students
found a problem and brought it to the Board of Trustees, or brought it to you, and then you brought it to the Board of Trustees.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Pretty much.
Yeah. So it's a nice arrangement.
Yeah.
One of the things that I'll just add to what the students have said is that Sizer is a mission-driven school.
Mission.
Yep. So we have a belief, and our mission is essentially we involve students in Think Care Act. So if you walk into our building, you'll see the words Think Care Act splashed across the main atrium. Mm-hmm. And that indicates the kind of place we are, that we're not interested in students just amassing a lot of information as part of their education like it was when I was in school. But we're really helping kids learn to participate in and value thinking, caring, acting about their world and the greater world behind them. So it's a very kind of an activist kind of education.
Activist.
Getting kids to take the driver's seat of their own learning and realize that their passions and their interests and their questions are really the source of the education. So it's located in the human being rather than being something that's in a textbook or in some information outside.
So if you're in a class and you have a particular question about something, you would have the flexibility to explore that in different ways.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely.
In fact, you guys might want to talk about the idea of essential questions.
So I'm just going to talk about this first because it connects to what Mr. Perrigo was just saying. So the juniors and seniors do, Div 3. So the juniors have Junior X and the seniors have Senior Project or Senior X. How it changed a little bit, so to my understanding, the juniors come up with an essential question, which is supposed to be an open-ended question. It can be about any topic. We have them in almost every class, but I can't think of any of them off the top of my head.
Why do humans exist?
Basically, very, very broad questions that we can explore in depth in many different ways. Mm. But for Junior X, your goal by the end of the year is to have an EQ, an essential question, and a claim, and you're supposed to have a proposal for your senior project. And when you're a senior, you have to work on getting your product done. So, like, how are you going to
solve that question?
Yeah. So what I'm doing is I'm very interested in the arts, and I'm very passionate about our theater program, which unfortunately doesn't have a lot of funding at the moment. So my essential question is, why are the arts important in education?
Mm. Good question.
And so my ideal product would be bringing a proposal to the Board of Trustees. To work out a budget plan so we can get more funding.
More funding for the arts. Yes, that sounds good.
So you guys might also want to talk about all the other things. We talked about the athletics, but in addition to our theater arts program, we have tons of other extra opportunities.
Yeah, definitely.
Youth venture. Want to list them off?
Yeah, peer mediation. I'm an active member of peer mediation, which is like a good way for students to help their community become more unified.
Peer mediation,
student government.
Youth Venture is like an organization that you propose to the Youth Venture organization something. Like, for example, I'm part of the green team. We're part of the green team, and we propose to make our school greener. And when we first moved to the new building, we didn't have any way to recycle anything. So we brought that up, and we got money. And from them, they gave us $1,000, and we were able to get recycling bins in all the rooms. And we had extra money, so we went and got compost bins so we can compost.
I saw those up front, right?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
We can. More of those garden bins.
We have garden clubs.
So now we compost all the waste that we don't use as compost.
That's great.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So there are a variety of things. There's art clubs, sparring, Sizer Singers, which is chorus, our Sizer Theater Arts, which is CIDA. We have a gardening club, the Green Team, United Way Adventure. There's a ton of after-school activities, and they were all student-initiated.
Mm-hmm. That all sounds great.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Okay, we only have a couple minutes left, so how do students that want to go to Sizer, how do you enroll? And do you have a maximum capacity, and have you met that?
Yep, so I can answer that question. We do have a max capacity, and we are just about there. I believe 400 is our number.
400. And you're at 371?
We're at 376 right now.
So you haven't had to turn anyone away yet?
We do have people on our wait list, so everything's
based on grade levels
and who we have at each grade level. We open most at 7, 8, and 9, and we'll open 10, 11, and 12 based on discretion. So currently we are in our recruitment stage, and so we are having people submit their intent to enroll form through SizerSchool.org. Yep, it's not an application. It's just information about them and where they currently go to school, what grade level
they'll
be here.
It's like a pre-application.
They don't even have to apply. We actually pick names out of a hat for students to come to our school. I use a pretty silver bucket. But what will happen is their names get submitted through that form, and then on March 1st, we hold a lottery. And at that lottery, a third party will choose names out of the silver bucket, and the order in which they're picked is the order in which they're offered a seat at Sizer.
So it's a literal lottery.
It is. Mm. Yeah.
Okay.
There are only some few that get preference, and those are siblings of current students. Get picked first. Mm-hmm. And then everyone in our chartered towns and districts will get picked second. And then anybody outside of those will get picked third at each grade level.
That sounds reasonable. Mm-hmm. All right. Okay, we're out of time. Anything else you want to close with?
Thank you so much for having us.
This
has been a great program.
Thank you so much. Thanks, everybody, for coming on and telling us about Sizer School. Yeah. Okay, we're going to cut to a quick break, and we're going to have Fitchburg High School on next.
Chess Chat is the only television program in the United States that presents chess in the way we do it. We try to be entertaining. We try to actually inform, educate our viewers as far as the world of chess, which is a fascinating world. If more people took up chess, and especially young players, they would actually be exposed to critical thinking, learning logic. I mean, I think this is very valuable for especially youngsters, you know, at an early age, to learn to be critical in their thinking, because I want to let people know that chess is a fantastic game, but it's also an art, it's a science, it's a sport. The world of chess has a wealth of information about chess. We could go on forever talking about chess, chess players, chess events. I and my co-host will never run out of material for Chess Chat.
I think of wellness as such a broad term, because when we think of wellness, it's emotional wellness, it's physical wellness, it's social wellness. You know, there's all these components of wellness that mean something different to you than they do to me. And we're seeing that with the variety of guests that we get on, and they go, how does this connect to wellness? Because we always think of wellness as a component of health. You know what I mean? I believe in everything that we do here at FATV, you know, where it's community involvement, where it's volunteerism, where there's civility, you know, opportunity. So if my message can be to the community, my God, these are things that you can do to improve your health or improve your life or recognize these signs and symptoms before they really get to be problematic, then I've done my job.
Welcome back to Discussing Fitchburg Now. We have our final segment for our public high school options with Fitchburg High School. We have Principal Jeremy Roche and Superintendent Andre.
Hi, Sam.
And Shalana, our student.
Yep.
Yes.
Thanks for having us.
Welcome.
Thank you.
Yeah. Okay, Fitchburg High School. So I feel like we could talk about this for an hour.
Yes.
But let's start with the main advantages of choosing Fitchburg High School.
Right. Well, I think I'm going to just hand it right over to Jeremy, since he's there every day and probably can give you a closer view.
I think, you know,
We are a fully comprehensive school serving all the students in the city of Fitchburg. As such, we offer a wide variety of courses, extracurriculars, advanced courses. We probably have the most in the area with 16 advanced placement courses, dual enrollment courses. We have Montachusett Community College right on our campus every day working with our students, Fitchburg State agreements, and we have a tremendous amount of support. So we meet every kid at the door when they come in as freshmen or whenever they move to Fitchburg High School. And I think we're really able to offer them an enriched and supported and dynamic education that's social, that's civic, that's academic, that really hits the whole gamut.
Mm. So you're the one school that accepts all students. There's
Absolutely.
No lottery. If a student applies to Fitchburg High, they get in. Correct?
There's no application to Fitchburg High
There's
School.
No application. Right.
We've been looking for, even in public education, we've been looking for a descriptor for the kind of high school we are, and comprehensive high school doesn't even say it. It's really an inclusive high school.
All inclusive.
Because it's again, whether you know you don't speak the language, whether you have any kind of a special needs issue, whether you're homeless and looking for a place to school, you just have to show up at Fitchburg High, and within 24 hours, you're in a classroom, and somebody is developing a response for your education.
So you go the wide range of mm-hmm. talents and abilities.
Absolutely.
Now, is that why you have so many different schools within your school, like the Honors Academy, which mm-hmm. gets the rave reviews? There's the Goodrich Academy. Mm-hmm. I don't know if that's a part of the high school.
No,
or
Goodrich Academy is a separate high school.
Separate high school.
So it's its own high school, right.
But do people apply to Goodrich, or do they apply to FHS and
You can apply to either. If you're from outside, 40% of the students that attend Goodrich are not from Fitchburg. They're from surrounding communities.
Huh.
So 60% of the students there are from Fitchburg. And if you're at Fitchburg High School, you don't automatically go to Goodrich. There's a whole process that says basically what's being offered or the schedule or whatever at Fitchburg High is not meeting your needs. And I think I mentioned that to you, that they're students with accelerated lives. Mm. You know, something is happening in their life. They're homeless. They need a job, they haven't been able to make it, they've dropped out. There's a reason why they go to Goodrich, which is at a different time also. It's from noon to, I think, around 8 o'clock at night.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
It's at a different, mm-hmm. it's at a more
right.
flexible time
yes.
for different students.
Because a lot of the
needs.
Students that go there have to work. They're supporting themselves,
they might have
jobs.
Take,
yeah, exactly.
Mm-hmm.
Right.
And so you have other schools, Honors Academy, there's the STEM, I saw there was a STEM Academy. And
sure.
And a school within
school
a school.
Within a school.
Yeah. So, I mean, like you said, I think, and Shalana can probably speak better than I could even about the Honors Academy because she's a charter member of it. But we do have freshman teams, and the Honors Academy is one, I think, that does have an application process, mm-hmm. though, because of just the nature of it. It's a very advanced program. But we have a great STEM Academy that's freshman team. We have the school within a school, which was actually our first freshman team. And all of these programs are one-to-one, meaning students are assigned or have access to a computer in all of their academic classes or throughout the day even. So this year we even added an ESL teaching team as well for those students who are second language learners. So that's
a teaching team.
Teaching team, yeah. So the students are kind of grouped together essentially by their teachers. So they can take different classes. But for four or five of their classes, they're going to have a group of teachers who really focus on the academic and social and civic experience that they're having. So that's the same approach that we have with the Honors Academy, STEM Academy, SWS, School Within a School, and the ESL team. And I think for us, it's helping students in making that transition to high school, or again, as I said earlier, and as Superintendent Ravenel mentioned too, just helping students with where they are. You know, what is it that you need to be successful? If it's learning the language, then we're going to provide a team for that.
Sounds like it's really individualized
attention
for those that need it.
As much as we can possibly do that. It's highly personalized is the term we use. And,
personalized.
You know, I think Shalana can speak to the Honors Academy experience.
You're in the Honors Academy?
I am.
Everyone raves about the FHS Honors Academy. Is it tough to get in?
So I would say I'm a member of the first cohort of the Honors Academy.
First cohort.
Yeah, so my year was the first year they introduced the program.
Oh, okay.
And so...
So you're a senior now?
Yes. It's been going for 4 years, and as years have gone on, we've made improvements, but it was challenging. It is challenging, and it's great to have, just to make sure that I'm on track, that I have a group of teachers and, like, friends who are like-minded and share the same goals as mine. So it's really nice to have that centered kind of path for you.
What is your goal? What are these goals? You know.
I would just say to like, as in challenging yourself. So, I think a lot of students, it's hard for them to take on the challenge by themselves. And having friends and having the teachers ready and like there for you and available for any extra help or any, you know, any needs in general, like whether it's personal or whether it's school related. For someone to just be right there and be able to push you to, you know, maybe the next AP class or try something new, I would say.
And so what the Honors Academy is every class is more challenging than in standard curriculum?
Well, they're all, we have academic levels, so they're all honors level. And then there are requirements for the students to maintain a certain grade point average as well as take a number of advanced placement courses, which are essentially college courses approved by the college board, which does tests like SATs, PSATs,
so,
and then the
advanced AP
placement.
Classes and dual enrollment?
As well as dual enrollment, because we have a great compact agreement with Fitchburg State. So we offer two dual enrollment courses a year to students in the Honors Academy, and we even open up to other students who are interested, and those are free of charge. We've had some great experience
great
with
deal.
Those,
mm-hmm.
and yeah, you know, I mean, our goal is, and you know, Shalana won't toot her own horn, but you're talking to a WCVB Channel 5 A-plus scholar, a Hamilton scholar, a Telluride scholar, sitting in between.
Are those scholarships that you've
yes.
been awarded?
Well, these are national experiences in certain national recognitions, I should say, about, you know, Hamilton. I think it's a very small number of students nationally who get this.
Congratulations.
And, thank you.
You know, she's one of many students, you know, and not just Honors Academy. We get a lot of recognition mm-hmm. for that, but STEM, SWS, and even other programs that we have at the high school, I think, again, are you know, if a student comes to us and they want to put some effort in, they're going to have so many offerings and opportunities at the end of their experience that that's going to be challenging, managing all those.
Mm-hmm. Well, and if I can say, I think one of the, not just for Fitchburg High School, but I think for the district is, you know, my commitment has always been, we build our programs and our responses based on the needs of the students, not on our needs of the administrators or the adults.
You get hands-on.
Who are they?
Yeah.
And really, right. 5 years ago, 6 years ago, none of these things existed. We started with the school within a school.
Yeah.
We started with the Honors Academy. No, school within
school first,
then the Honors Academy, then the STEM Academy, now ELL, just as we targeted and found specific groups, because the goal is find what the passion is for a student. What is their passion? What is it that keeps them coming back to school every day? And I know in our questions of things to talk about, one of them was athletics.
Mm.
Five years ago.
Is that a big driver?
Well, 5 years ago, our athletic program at the high school was dying out.
Really?
Because we had no feeder program. There were no middle school sports.
Oh,
so
5 years
ago,
no feeder program.
So 5 years ago, I implemented free middle school sports at all of our middle schools for all of the sports. And now we see we're building that high school program. And the same thing with music. You know, our band program was starting to die out. Now we have a music program. And for almost 12 years, there were no high school musicals, and now we're going into our fourth year of a high school musical. So people look at those things and say, well, that's just, you know, baseball, or it's just a musical, but for some student, it's what's their passion, and it's what makes them come to school every day.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and I know that you have you really push attendance, right?
Well,
do
yes.
Do kids get awards based on attendance per grade level?
So we do attendance challenges and different incentive activities. We'll do a quarterly one because I think we have a pretty strict attendance policy, because we've heard over and over again from groups like the Chamber of Commerce locally, or the, you know, the Workforce Development Council that one of the skills that, that people need in society is attendance and punctuality. I mean, you know, we've heard this frequently. You know, we're pursuing a vocational program of our own, so we got advice about this. And many of these groups said, no, really, just reinforce attendance. So that said, the students gave us some great ideas to do incentives. So we did, I think, about 8 or 10 different incentive awards, and kids get raffles, you know, based on attendance. And we did those right before the holiday break. We'll do it again in a couple of weeks once the attendance is set up, you know, clarified for quarter two. But yeah, attendance is a huge piece of being successful in life. I think Woody Allen said something about 90% of all success is simply showing up. So
isn't that the truth?
You know, there's something to be said for that.
Yeah. Great. Okay, so what can you expect in 5 years from now? You got any big changes? You said you're working on a vocational program?
Well, I mean, you know, our goal is to always find ways to improve and to serve the students in the city of Fitchburg. And so we look at opportunities. And interestingly enough, being at FATV tonight, we have a tremendous FATV satellite studio right at the high school.
So, FHS Studios?
Yeah, so so we're looking to make that an actual
and you do
vocational.
A morning, you do a morning broadcast, right? Yeah, we have
courses that feed into that. But we want to make it a little more official so that it's a vocational program.
You're getting credits.
So students get credentials as well, you know, a field, a career credential that says, I completed these courses and I'm now employable in the field of television broadcasting or editing or whatever the various other fields. Because many, you know, many companies employ videographers for a little web link videos that they're putting together. So there's all kinds of opportunities there.
FSU courses.
For sure. Right. So we've made connections with Montachusett.
FATV, the wonderful resource.
And Fitchburg State, you know, are all on board with this program. So, I mean, I think 5 years from now, we hope to continue our enrollment increasing. We hope to you know, exceed even some of our expectations for students graduating and the AP courses that they're taking. You know, we've gotten recognized by the College Board for the past 3 years, thanks to people like Shalana taking the challenge. But we've,
with all
you know,
their credentials.
Yeah, we've had 530 you know, AP tests taken in just a few different a few
530
years.
530 AP tests.
Yeah, yeah. So that you know, the College Board's recognized Fitchburg High School 3 years in a row as an AP honor roll school. You know, one of only 500 in the nation, and that includes Canada too. So that's a lot of high schools, and right here in Fitchburg, you know, we're one of those. And
one
again, it really has to do with people like Shalana, the teachers who work very hard, you know, and the support that we get from the central office and the school committee. Because I think it's a team effort in Fitchburg, and that's what I love. You know, we really work together. No question about it. In a great community.
Some things to add to it. We want to give you a chance to talk, one of the students, but
yeah, I mean, because honestly,
your experience and
I think the best thing about Fitchburg High School is the atmosphere and the opportunity. So when I walk in the door, there's always people there to greet you, whether they know you or not. So I mean, whether it's a friendly smile or like a wave, it's like something to cheer you up every single day. And it's just, I know at other schools, like, some people feel out of place or, like, that no one really knows them or they can't help them. But, like, there's always someone somewhere at FHS ready to invite you in and, like, just be your friend, anything. And also the opportunities.
Friendly. Friendly environment.
Yeah, definitely. Yeah. So the opportunities in FHS are, like, endless, I would say. The AP classes, being able to take courses at FSU and, like, earn credits in high school. And usually those credits would cost, like, thousands of dollars. So just to get it for free is absolutely amazing.
That is great. And then you
helps
have
the whole family.
You have a foot right into college.
Right.
No question.
Well, and with the Honors Compact, students who are in the honors program at Honors Academy, if they maintain a certain grade average, they're automatically accepted into the honors program at Fitchburg State. And they receive scholarship money.
Yeah, annually.
So that's good incentive
to
work hard.
So there's some real financial benefits, not just for the student, but for the family, for the parents. I mean, what do we hear all the time? The cost of college, the college debt, all of that. So while we're offering opportunities to kids, if we can help their families to also get you know, ahead in some of these areas. It's good. And the other part is the Honors Academy can't happen all by itself. And we have an advanced academic learning initiative in the elementary schools. We have coaches that take kids that are ready to do more.
A feeder program.
There you go.
But then we reached the high school five years ago and went, okay, now these kids are coming. They're like way ahead of where they could be. And what are we going to do for them? And that's when the Honors Academy came. And I think, you know, the numbers tell the story. Last year we had 140 more students in Fitchburg Public Schools. This year we just had 120 more students. And at one point, within my time, I'm in my 12th year here, at one point we were under 1,000 students at Fitchburg High, and now we're at 1,200.
1,200?
Yes.
That's a lot.
So people are taking action with their feet and coming to Fitchburg High because it's got great opportunities.
FHS, I hear so much about. I hear nothing but positive things coming up and over. Well, thank you so much for coming on.
Thank you.
And telling us about Fitchburg High School. Thank you, everyone, for watching. This is Discussing Fitchburg Now.